Before getting to the topic of the video, I need to make a premise. Hideaki Anno, creator of both Gunbuster and Evangelion, has always carried with him in his original stories a certain, let's say, character. The character in question is Asuka, not Soryu or Shikinami, just Asuka. She has existed at least since Gunbuster and has assumed a variety of names and identities throughout Anno's works. Jungfreud in Gunbuster, Nadia in The Secret of Blue Water, Soryu Asuka Langley in Neon Genesis, Shikinami Asuka Langley in The Rebuild, and even Kayoko Ann Patterson in Shin Godzilla, of all places. The defining characteristics of all or most of these characters, that for simplicity I refer to as Asuka, are being maternal orphans, being foreign, or at most a quarter Japanese, being ambitious or driven to achieve something, to stand out from others, oftentimes being competitive, very talented in their field, let's say prodigies, being somewhat selfish and self-centered, hot-headed and impulsive, and vain in the sense that they care a lot about their physical appearance and or beauty. Lastly, they tend to show up late in the story, to then quickly and unexpectedly gain relevance, ending up as either triteragonists or deuteragonists. Of all the mentioned characters, I would say that Nadia is the outlier, as she shares the least amount of characteristics, but I do still feel comfortable grouping her up with the rest. In this video, I will explore a sequence that not only connects Anno's first meaningful original work to his ongoing last, but also a sequence that links together the first Asuka, Jungfreud, to the last Asuka, Shikinami Asuka Langley, what it is about, and what it could signify for Shikinami's future in 3+1. Let's get to it then, and of course, spoilers for Gunbuster. First of all, I think a brief summary for Gunbuster and its characters is necessary. So, alien monsters are heading towards Earth. Humans are trained to pilot mechs to stop their advance. Pretty simple. Our two main characters, Noriko and Kazumi, are among the team pilots chosen to be sent to space at the end of the first episode to function as the vanguard against the alien forces. They are also deemed two of the most likely candidates to pilot the Gunbuster, which is humanity's greatest weapon in this war and requires two people to make it function properly. But there is a third candidate. Her name is Jungfreud, a hot-headed and competitive Russian prodigy. She's the first full-fledged Asuka and the character we will focus on. Freud's journey throughout the story can be summarized as her constantly trying to distinguish herself and prove her superiority over Noriko and Kazumi, only to be thwarted not by her inability, but by unfortunate circumstances. This, of course, mainly for the purpose of becoming one of the pilots of the Gunbuster, but also, though it may sound a bit awkward, to gain a more central role in the story. Twice does she challenge in a duel Noriko and Kazumi, and twice is she forced to stop when she would likely have won. The first time as they come across the corpse of an alien while fighting, the second time as Noriko gets a PTSD episode just before the fight, and Freud loses her competitive streak. I mean, she even falls in love with Kazumi's romantic interest, only to be forced to give up on him. And there is more, but I think you get the idea. Though it may seem like it, Freud is not unkind. She develops a strong friendship with both Noriko and Kazumi, even as they are the ones that end up being chosen to pilot the Gunbuster. But anyway, let's fast forward to the end of the series. Episode 6, the last chance for humanity to stop the aliens. Kazumi, who had given up her spot in the Gunbuster to spend time on Earth with her boyfriend, heads back to space to participate to this last fight. While she was away, of course, it was Freud who had been piloting in her place. Though we don't actually get to see that, because things, they simply can't go the way Freud would like them to go. This brings us to the scene that I was referencing earlier, the title of the video. Freud goes to talk to Kazumi, passes her the keys to the Gunbuster, gives her a nice slap in the face, and tells her that things always seem to go her way. Though this may give the impression that Freud was forced to give up her spot as the pilot, that is not the case. Freud knew how important it was for Noriko and Kazumi to spend this time together, and chose to sacrifice her own ambitions and wishes for the sake of their friendship. This sequence reverberates forward all the way to Evangelion 2.22. Shikinami Ascalangli proves herself capable of real kindness when she offers herself as the test pilot for Unit 03 to allow Shinji and Rei to share their dinner together. The implication, of course, being that if Asuka hadn't done that, Rei would have been chosen instead, and in that case, bye-bye dinner. While the specifics of these two sequences differ, they are in essence the exact same. Just like Freud and Shikinami are different, and yet they are both Asuka. A character, generally portrayed as selfish, demonstrates potential for kindness by allowing its two friends to be together, even as it goes against its own interests. And it just so happens that those two friends care more about one another than they care about, well, said character, so Asuka or Freud. But what is Freud's fate in Gunbuster? Is she rewarded for her actions? No, she's not. In fact, one could argue that she's even punished for them. During the last fight, Noriko and Kazumi sacrificed themselves to trigger a black hole to suck in all of the aliens. It's complicated. But they themselves get stuck in it. Freud tries to follow them, but she is convinced that there is no point in throwing her life away, because her own mech is kind of shitty and it can't withstand the pressure. She is then promised by Noriko and Kazumi that they will meet again. Of course, that does not happen. The last image of Freud we are left with is one of her crying after she gets back to the spaceship. Noriko and Kazumi, of course, do not die. They are able to come back to Earth, but 1,000 years into the future. As they are closing in on Earth, they realize that in anticipation for their return, humanity had prepared a message using lights that spelled, "Welcome back." They are happy to be back. The end. Freud cries, Noriko and Kazumi smile. Now, I would say here, what the fuck? But let's just ask why instead. So why? Why is this the case? The true act of kindness is the one Freud makes, and yet it is Noriko and Kazumi who end up being rewarded for it. Now, I'm not saying that Noriko and Kazumi should not be happy, but that Freud is in no way less deserving. I'm sure Anno has come to realize the same, which leads us back to Evangelion. Now, of course, this is just my opinion, but my belief is that the reason why this sequence repeats in 2.22 is because Anno is intentioned not to let Asuka's gesture go unrewarded this time around. The scene takes place halfway through the story, and not at the very end, when, well, one could argue there is no time left to reward the gesture. But how could Shikinami ever be rewarded? Who could do it? Well, it could only be Rei. Nobody else knows about what she has done, other than Misato. And to be fair, the end result of her sacrifice, it kind of indirectly caused humanity to nearly go extinct, but we'll pretend to ignore that. My point is that Rei is shown to be grateful to her. And as Rei is known to overreact to kindness, if we think about Shinji's relationship with Rei, one could say that simply because Shinji told her that she should smile more often, Rei decided that it was appropriate to blow herself up to protect him. You know, it's Rei. She functions a bit differently. Let's just get back to the topic. But the thing is that Rei from 2.22 is gone, right? But as I'm sure many people have come to believe, that is not necessarily the case. Let's set aside the trailer. Let's not speculate as to who that sort of Rei-looking person may be. But it seems to me very likely that 2.22 Rei is now the soul that resides in the 01. So the chances that she will be back in some capacity are pretty good. If so, I would absolutely expect her to do something to pay Asuka back. What that may be, I cannot say. Some closing thoughts. With this video, we have established the third path that connects a certain character in Evangelion to Asuka. The first path is the path of fairy tales, traversed by Prince Shinji in his efforts to save Princess Asuka. The second path is the path of motherhood, that leads Mari to being Asuka's mother, unlikely though it may be. The third path is the path of echoes, of friendship, that connects Ray to Asuka, in hope that 3 plus 1 will make right what Gambaster did wrong, and we will see Ray rewarding Asuka for the kindness she showed her in 2.22. I think that, bearing in mind these connections, and of course without forgetting Asuka's own dual nature, human and angelic, we can get an idea as to what we could expect from her in this final movie. Shinji will redeem himself for his failures in End of Evangelion and 2.22 by saving Asuka. Mari will reveal herself as Asuka's mother, filling an emotional void that has accompanied her since the original series. Rei will do what Rei does and protect Asuka in some way to express her disproportionate gratitude, because, as you know, the fact that Asuka made that kind gesture did not result in anything positive for Rei. But again, we'll ignore that. Asuka will use her angelic powers to deliver the Spear of Cassius in the heart of the planet, purifying it from the corruption. Okay, though I would like it to be true, I can't convince myself that Mari is Asuka's mother, nor that Anno will abandon the idea of making Shinji the savior of Earth. What is more likely to happen is that Asuka will use her angelic powers to fend off an attack from multiple enemies, succeeding where she failed in End of Evangelion. But this isn't what the video is about, so I'll just leave it at that.